Good morning, everybody. My name is Christy Gagan, and I'm with the City of Pickering, and you are all participating in our first Earth Month webinar that we've got scheduled for this month. We have three additional webinars, so I encourage you to check out our website, pickering.ca/Earth Month, to join us in our further webinars. But most important, thank you for coming today, and I am so excited that we are going to learn about the importance of pollinators. So thank you all for coming. It's going to be so exciting. I have three very special guests here from Durham Master Gardeners. The first one, if you could just wave when I say your name so everybody can see you, is Corey. Can you wave, Corey? Perfect. And then we've got Isha from Durham Master Gardeners. Isha, perfect. And then we've got Holly as well from Durham Master Gardeners. Holly Wave, excellent, thank you. So they will be teaching us all about pollinators today. As well, I've got more special guests, and I have two very special guests from Pickering Public Library. And these individuals work in our children's services. We've got Sedia there, yeah. And we've got Chloe with us. And they are going to help us with our craft with the grab bags that hopefully you all picked up from the George Ash Library this week. If not, no worries. You can grab supplies from around the house, so don't panic. And last but not least, we've got Jenna from Toronto and Region Conservation Authority. Morning, Jenna. And Jenna is going to be kind of our mediator. She's going to help if we've got questions. She'll help answer defer the questions to our pro master gardeners to answer the questions for you. So Jenna's going to be on the back end helping. And with that, I'm going to pass the floor over to Jenna because she is going to go through some housekeeping rules this morning so that we all can fall in line with the webinar and enjoy the most out of it. Okay, so Jenna, without further ado, I'm going to pass the floor to you. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Good morning, everybody. So just some quick housekeeping rules here. If you are logging in from a smartphone or a tablet, you should be able to swipe between the webcam view and the speaker view, as well as the slides view. So you can see both the speaker and the presentation. I know we have a very exciting presentation, so we want to make sure you can see that as well. If you do have a question, please just enter it into the chat or wait until the question period. We will address these questions during the question breaks. And we ask that you do stay muted through this presentation just to limit background noise, but please feel free to unmute if you do have a question. And lastly, this presentation is being recorded, just the presentation, not the webcams, and we will not be sharing the recording until it is finalized. But we will be sharing resources. And without further ado, I'd like to pass it over to get the presentation begin. So Corey, take it away.
So everyone, as you see, as it slides into view here, this is a Master Gardener presentation for kids. It's actually quite an honor to be doing this because this is the first virtual presentation that we have done for kids. COVID, as you know, changed things, but I'm sure most of you as students, as children, have already become masters of watching Zoom and Google Classroom and all the different technology that you need to use when you were doing virtual school. So we're without any delay, we're going to continue. We have a little bit on the Durham Master Gardeners. We're an organization, we're international, but we are also in Canada, the US, and your local Master Gardeners are our Durham Master Gardeners. So we take care of this region where we all live. We have experience in various areas of gardening. We do presentations, we do workshops, both hands-on and virtual, and we work with community groups. So quite often you may see us out in parks or community gardens and doing some speaking tours, just helping other gardeners and environmentalists to make our world a little bit better. And you'll see at the end of our presentation that we talk a lot about teamwork. And you are a very, very important part of that team. because you hold the future in your hands just as we do now. So we will be working together with you so that you have all the skills and the knowledge that you need to move forward in a very positive, positive manner. All right, for those of you who were fortunate enough to pick up your resource packages on your curbside for your craft materials, we have resources, a page in there as well, all kinds of age groups, all kinds of activity suggestions and sites for all ages of kids and parents too. We haven't left you out, parents, and we hope that there's lots of parents sitting with their kids today. We have some books on pollinators of native plants and bumblebees of North America that are specifically listed for parents and kids. There are fantastic pictures in those books, so hopefully you'll have a chance to see some of those as well. This is a very, very special year, 2022. 2022 is the year of the garden, and it's from the website at the bottom. It's gardenscanada.ca. So if you check it out, as it says right there, you can go and see all the different festivals, activities, what local people are doing, what people are doing right across Canada to celebrate the Year of the Garden. So it's going to be a very beautiful, very busy, and wonderful year for pollinators, I'm thinking, with all these lovely flowers and gardens going in. All right, Pollinator Week is coming up in June, and there's another website for you to take a look at there, www.pollinator.org. Lots of information, activities on that site as well. So that's coming up in June. And an ongoing site that you might be interested in is Pollinator Partnerships Canada. More and more environmental organizations are partnering with schools and school boards and communities and libraries and cities, and they're just all getting together to help make our environment better and to help our pollinators. We have set up this agenda specifically in questions. Questions lead to all kinds of information. It's so important in life to learn how to ask good questions. And you'll see that there's a connection to this, possibly if we get time for the activity after your craft. So look at the questions. That's what we're focusing on today. What is pollen? Where is pollen? What is pollination? Who is a pollinator? Why are pollinators important? And most importantly of all, how can I help? That's myself. It's my colleagues from Master Garden, it's the people from the library, the city, the TRCA, and it's you. It's everyone that's listening and watching today. How can you help? There's more questions, lots of opportunity for you to jump in there and ask anything that's on your mind to do with our pollinators and gardening today. And then I know that you're really looking forward to the craft time at the end. So we'll try to keep moving along right through. First question, what is pollen? And I bet most of you have a very good idea of what pollen is. I have allergies, so I know what pollen is because it's the little particles in the air from the plants every spring, sometimes again at the end of summer. And they're little tiny pollen particles that get up my nose and make me sneeze and my eyes water and my face gets a little red. And my throat gets a little scratchy, but it's all an important step in what we're talking about today. So I don't really mind. I spend all my time outside and with plants, even when I'm at work. So it's something that I've just come to get used to. Pollen are tiny little spores or particles. They are in a seed plant, mainly flowering plants, and they're a fine dust. So they get floating in the air or in the water. They coat the bees and the butterflies and the other pollinators that we'll talk about. And each pollinator grain is actually a tiny single body. It can be a different shape, different textures. Some of them are spiny. Some of them are oval shaped. Some of them are sticky. You can see the little egg shaped in the picture that I'm showing now. They're yellow and shiny. Look at these. These are probably from under a microscope, but there's some that look almost like a chestnut. Some of them have a lace coating on them. Some of them look like they're full of holes. Some of them look a bit like seashells, but they're all different shapes and sizes. And they're formed in the male structure of the seed-bearing or flowering plant. And then here, there's another special part that often goes with the pollen, is nectar. And nectar is that sticky, gooey, sweet, it's almost like syrup that the butterflies and the hummingbirds and bats and the bees like to suck up through either their beak if they're a bird, or the mouth parts of the other insects and the bats and the moths. And that's what they use for their own nutrition. If you've had too much sugar, too much of a sugary pop or a sugary drink, you know exactly how much energy is in that drink. All that sugar gives them lots of go, go, go energy for them to fly and fly for miles and miles and miles and do their job as pollinators. But honeybees in particular use that nectar and they take it back and they make it into the honey that we enjoy. So nectar is more than just being sweet and sugary and giving them energy. It's rich in vitamins, salts, oils, and other nutrients. So it's extremely nutritious for them as well. You can see this little bee just popping along from flower to flower to flower. They're attracted to certain shapes and sizes of flowers. Each pollinator has its favorite. It could be a favorite color, a favorite shape. It's whatever makes it easier for it to get the nectar and the pollen from. Where is the pollen? Remember I said it's in the male part of the seed-bearing plant. A flowering plant is often the one that has seeds. And you can see the large piece that's pushing out from that flower. And you can see the yellow coated pollen, little tiny particles, as we said, sticking to it. And there's more to come on that.
Okay, hi guys. We're so glad to be with you all today. My name is Holly, and I'm going to be talking about what is pollination and also who are the pollinators that contribute to the process that Corey just did a great job of showing us. So when a pollinator, and we're going to talk about those different creatures that live in our world that help with pollination when they actually pollinate, we'll talk a little bit more about them in a minute, but we're actually going to see what the process is now. So you can see in this diagram that you see a little ladybug here. And the first thing that that little pollinator will do will visit a flower. So they're visiting a flower. They're going to be maybe moving, crawling around on it, or hovering over, and maybe rubbing up against the flower. And they're going to be collecting the pollen on their bodies when they're doing that. So in the second picture, you see that the pollen sticks to the pollinator. And we'll talk a little bit about that too. And then in the third picture, you'll see that this little pollinator is also going to other flowers. So they're busy going to several flowers during the day. And when they go to the next flower, they actually, there's a sticky piece on the flower called the sigma. And if the pollen reaches that sigma, it will start the process of pollinating the flower. So the seeds, the pieces inside that flower that when they're pollinated will become seeds and will become fruits. So we're gonna look a little bit more in depth with that. And so you guys can watch this video of how pollination actually works. And it's a really good video to teach you.
My name is Tess with the Cincinnati Nature Center, and I want you to quickly imagine with me that you're super hungry, walking along the street when you see a bright sign that says free food. Jackpot. Well, if if you're a pollinator like this bee, that flower's bright petals and sweet smell is the same as that sign. It's saying, there's some free nectar in here if you just come pollinate me. So what is pollination and how does it work? As the bee approaches the flower in search of its free snack, it's going to run into a lot of parts of the flower first. That nectar that it wants is way down there at the bottom of the flower, next to the petals. So what are all these things that it's bumping into? Just like all living things, flowers need to reproduce so that their species can live on for years to come. They have some pretty special body parts that help them do this. First, they've got the stamens here. This is the male part of the flower. And at the top, you can find all that fluffy pollen, the stuff that might make you sneeze in the spring. They also have a female part. That's the pistil right here in the center. In the pistil, you might be able to find some teeny tiny eggs or ovules that will eventually turn into seeds. Now that we have a better idea of what these different parts of the flower are, let's see what happens when the bee bumps into them. As the bee travels around looking for nectar, it's going to bump into these stamens and get a bunch of pollen on it. It might already have some pollen from another flower as it collects some from this one. And you might have noticed that bees have pretty fuzzy bodies. Those hairs are really good at collecting this pollen. So good, in fact, that even when a bee's just cleaned itself, it can still have 10,000 pieces of pollen on its body. That's a lot. And it's not just bumping into these stamens either. It's also bumping in to our pistil. And as it does that, some of the pollen's going to fall off and stick to the sticky top of our pistil. This pistil has a few other tricks up its sleeve. Not only is it sticky at the top to collect that pollen, it can also sense something about it. It can sense if this pollen's from the same species of plant or not. If it is, then the flower's good to go, and it will grow a tube in the middle of the pistil that pollen can travel down. Once that pollen travels all the way down the pistil, it'll be down here with the ovule. Now the pollen and the ovule can fuse together and form a seed to make a new plant. Without the help of pollinators to move pollen from one plant to another, so many plants would have no way to reproduce and make new seeds. So let's be grateful for all of the hard work pollinators do in search of free food. My name is Tess with the Cincinnati.
So now we're going to be looking at who is actually a pollinator, and those are those creatures in the world that contribute to pollination. So let's start with one of probably the most popular and ones that you might think of when you think of pollination, and that's a bee. And so you see in this picture, there is a bee here, and this is a bee you would typically think of when you think of a bee, is a big fuzzy bumblebee. But there are over 4,000 species of bees in North America, and they very, very much range in what they look like, in their color, and the types of flowers that they pollinate. You could see a bee, and some of them don't even look like a bee. You might even think it's a fly, and they can be big and small, but they are excellent pollinators, and that's why I've started with them. So in this picture, you might be able to speculate why they are such great pollinators. If you can see here all the pollen on this bee. And when you see a bee pollinating a flower, you're going to be seeing mostly lady bees, because lady bees are the bees that are pollinating and doing the work to pollinate flowers. And as you can see, they're quite messy eaters, and that contributes to why they are such good pollinators, because when they're buzzing around on a flower and moving around, just like in the video we see, they're getting pollen all over them, and they have that fuzzy coat that helps the pollen stick. And another reason they're such fabulous pollinators, have such a high pollination rate when they are moving from flower to flower, is because they also have that fuzzy coat and a charge that's almost like a magnetism. So the pollen is actually pulling into their hair as well. So when I think of a bumblebee, I think of a messy eater, just like this little guy. And it kind of looks similar, doesn't it, in the picture, because he's a messy eater too. So one thing that Corey mentioned is that bees and other pollinators have their favorite flower shapes and colors. And for bumblebees, this color is yellow. So pollinators have different ways of seeing than we do. They can see colors differently. We're going to talk about that a little bit more. But for bees, yellow is a really, really drawing color for them. It's my favorite color too. So this is a yellow flower for my garden. I love yellow, so I have lots of yellow flowers to draw in the bumblebees. Another special thing that certain bees can do is called buzz pollination. So if you are looking at this picture, you don't see a bumblebee, but you're seeing a little piece of metal that can do something similar to bumblebee just because it shows it a little bit better. So bumblebees have a special skill. They can shake a flower in a way that the pollen gets pulled and dropped out of it, and see how much pollen can come out. They're really, really specialized in the way they can shake the flower. It's a very special movement. So there are even certain flowers that can only be pollinated by bumblebees. They are specially evolved together that the bee is the only one that can really get the pollen out of this flower and help the flower to reproduce and grow more flowers. Another thing about bees is that the hair on their bodies, depending on the bee, can be a little bit different. Some bees are going to have more concentration of hair, say on their face, if they're going through a flower that may be shaped more like a tube, so that they can collect the pollen on their face. But this bumblebee that you're looking at, she has special hairs on her legs that she is pulling the pollen with nectar. She's kind of making a sticky paste. It looks like she's kind of wearing funny pants. She's actually pulling pollen and the nectar onto the hairs on her back legs so she can collect it. So bees like honeybees, like Corey was saying, they're going to be collecting a lot of pollen and the nectar and bringing it back to their homes. And they bring it back to their homes to feed their other friends that live there and to feed their babies that they're going to be having. They actually make something called a pollen loaf, which is like a little cake for their babies when they hatch. So that's another thing that bees can do. Another pollinator, which is one of the most beautiful pollinators, are butterflies. So butterflies range too in how they look. Some are big, some are small, and the big ones you'll see have like swoopy movements, and you see the little one, they have very fluttery movements. And lots of people don't necessarily think of that butterflies are caterpillars before in their life. And so when you see a butterfly pollinating a flower, they're also looking around for places to lay their eggs. And they like to lay their eggs on plants that their babies, the caterpillars, can eat off of. And they can be very picky eaters. Some butterflies only like one type of plant and will only lay eggs on certain types of plants. So when I think butterfly or a caterpillar, I think this guy like a picky eater. So another picture, if you've ever seen a caterpillar or you've ever read the book Hungry, Hungry Caterpillar, you can appreciate this. So caterpillars are hungry, hungry creatures. And the reason that they are so hungry is they need so much energy to turn into a butterfly. So you see this caterpillar here, often they're eating all day. They're just eating and eating and eating, and they're getting bigger and bigger and bigger so that they can make a cocoon and eventually turn into a beautiful butterfly, just like this. And like bees, they range in size a lot. So here you see the smallest and the largest butterfly that we can find in North America. So the smallest is called a Western pygmy blue, and that's that little tiny guy on the left-hand side. And then you have a giant swallow. And just like proper dishes, so I wouldn't want to eat off a plate for a giant, butterflies like certain flowers that are matched their size. So you see in this picture, this butterfly likes little flowers because it's a nice size snack and he can handle that. And bigger butterflies might like a bigger flower with a big landing pad on it so that they can have lots of room. Another lovely pollinator that I'm going to talk about is a hummingbird. So we have different hummingbirds in North America, and a lot of them are migratory. So they like to take a lot of trips. and they love the color red. So if you have red flowers, they like orange too. If you have red or orange flowers, that's going to draw them in, and they might do a stop on their journey to go into your yard and have a snack. Another thing that I think Corey mentioned too is that the pollinators have different mouths to eat the pollen and the nectar. And so hummingbirds have really, really long beaks and really, really long tongues. So they like flowers that they can hover over. They don't have need to land and walk around like a bumblebee or a butterfly. They're not very keen on walking. They like to hover, and they like flowers that are shaped like cups. Because of their long beaks and tongues, they can reach far into a flower, and they're perfect for a hummingbird. So if you see flowers like this, this is perfect for a hummingbird. Another pollinator that I'd like to mention is our moths. And they look a lot like butterflies, but they are different. When you see a creature like this that has the beautiful wings and antenna, you might think butterfly, but it's not. Moths are often more fuzzy, and they have different color patterns than butterflies. Butterflies are very, very bright. And moths are more subdued kind of tones. But what's important to know about them is they like to eat at night. So they're looking for pollen and nectar in the dark. So what they like to see in a flower is something that's very bright. And the brightest thing that they can see is the color white. So they're going to be looking for flowers that they can see in the dark, like white flowers. And you can see, like this picture, everything is glowing. That's kind of, if you've ever seen anything about a moon garden, that's the concept, that everything kind of glows at night. Another pollinator that really likes to eat at night is a bat. And a bat, this cute little guy is a good example. They're going to be looking for bright flowers as well, because they're going to be feeding and hunting around at night for food. And that's not all. There's so many pollinators. So you have beetles and wasps and ants and flies, birds, and even wind. Certain plants like grasses, they don't need a creature to land on them and spread the pollen. They can spread the pollen through the wind, and even we can be pollinators. I know I'm growing a pep plant inside, and we take a little Q-tip and we move the pollen onto the between the flowers to get the peppers, because we don't have bees inside. So this is something really neat. So this is a video about how pollinators actually see. In this video, you're going to see three different views. First is what we see. Second is what a butterfly sees. And third is what a bee sees. So I hope you guys enjoy.
Thank you.
And now I'm going to hand everything over to my friend Isha.
Thank you, Holly. So what are pollinators, or why are pollinators important? Okay. Pollinators are important because they move pollen from one plant to another. Insect pollinators are the most efficient at moving this pollen. Without pollinators, we wouldn't be able to enjoy the food that we have. Some plants need to be pollinated in the spring when their flowers come out so that they can produce the food that we like apples and strawberries. In the beginning of the year, the flowers come and then they're pollinated. For some things like lettuce and herbs, we eat them throughout the year, but they don't get their flowers until the fall, at which point they're pollinated and they need to produce seeds so that we can have plants for next year. Some interesting facts are about a third of all the food we eat depends on pollination from bees, and over 75% of all flowering plants need pollinators, insects, and other animals in order to pollinate them. As Holly said, some of our crops depend on wind. Their pollen is so light, it gets picked up by the wind. So any of our cereal crops, like corn and oats, and all the grasses prefer or are easily pollinated by wind. Okay. So what can you do to help? Well, the more you learn about insects, as you are today, the better you'll be able to help them. As we've talked about, many insects like different environments. They like different food. They're looking for different plants in order to find that food. And when they find that food, then they're spreading that pollen around. So the more you can learn about them, the better. And if you were to take pictures of them or take some information, go to the library or online and try to identify them. And then maybe what you can do is create habitat for them. As we said, different pollinators do different things. So in some cases, they want open space, like the middle picture, which is great for solitary bees because they hibernate and they live in the ground. Others like a lot of color, like the picture on the left. And some of them like a lot of native plants, and they also like a lot of variety. So it's good to have all of that. Again, it's important to plant a variety of different flowers because the shapes are important to different pollinators, and also color. They like different color as well. Other things, shelter and food. So in this first, this bird bath, that's actually created for butterflies and smaller insects, because like you, they need water to survive, but they don't always like to get their feet wet. So having pebbles and that in the bird bath will help them be able to land and get the water they need. On the other side, there's a little bit of mud. Mud is used by some pollinators to create a home, sort of our mud wasps, mud bees. They all collect mud and create homes, but also there are minerals in the mud that pollinators also need, just like we do, vitamins and minerals. And so they will actually rub that on their body, so that will help them. And that's important to create that kind of environment for them as well. Later today, you're going to be creating a bird home, a bee home, which is similar to this one. Many bees lay their eggs in hollow tubes, and so you can create those, or you can provide for them with the plants that you put in the in your garden. Some of the best flowers for early spring is something like this. Remember, the birds and that are the bees and that are starting to come out now, and they're starting to look for food. So by providing food earlier in the spring, then you're helping them. This here is called prairie smoke, and it's one of the earliest blooming spring flowers, native, and it provides a lot of nectar and pollen, nectar for the spring pollinators. Some of the other flowers that are good, the columbine, which is this one here, it has a tube, hummingbirds like this one. So this tick seed here, this is great because it's an early spring flower, but it also, it makes really good honey. And it grows in conditions that a lot of other plants won't grow in or don't like. So it's a good option for an area that you're not sure about. Strawberries are early spring bloomers. And of course they produce food for us. And then we have the silver weed here, which bees and flies, which are also really good pollinators, really like. Next. Now, pollinators need food throughout the year. And so it's important to also have variety in the summer. This one here is bottle gentian. This one is one that bumblebees have to pollinate because they have to open it. It stays fairly closed. And also bees sometimes find it difficult, but they really like the nectar. So they'll actually chew into this flower. And once they've chewed into the flower, down by the base here where the nectar is, then it allows other pollinators to get in as well and enjoy that nectar, but also help pollinate. The coneflower here is a favorite of insects that have long tongues. The even though the petals are not closed, the center of this flower can be very spiky. And so most insects that pollinate this have long tongues so that they can reach in to get the nectar. The helianthus sunflower is a favorite of native bees, butterflies, and flies. And this coliver root is a really good one because it starts to bloom when the spring flowers start to finish, but before the summer flowers are actually blooming. So this is a good in-between one. And it's loved by all kinds of pollinators, bees, butterflies, wasps, and even moths. Okay. Next, also remember we need to have pollinators in the fall, and so some of the best flowers for pollinators, believe it or not, goldenrod, which is loved by pretty much all pollinators, beetles and bees, moths, wasps, everyone likes the goldenrod. And Corey had started off by saying that pollen is what causes you to sneeze if you're allergic. Oftentimes, goldenrod gets a bad name because it comes into bloom at the same time as ragweed. And ragweed is what you're actually allergic to or what causes you to sneeze. Goldenrod is not. The pollen doesn't travel in the wind the same. And so it's still a good one to plant. It's not one that most people have allergies to. Then we also have the aster here. Bees and butterflies love the aster. And this is the native prairie coneflower, which is a favorite of many bees. Okay. Next. You've probably heard about the monarch butterflies. This is milkweed, and it's a favorite of the monarch butterfly family. As Holly had said, pollinators look for specific plants for their caterpillars. And even though you'll find monarch butterflies will feed off of all kinds of different flowers, they actually need this for the caterpillars. The caterpillar of the monarch butterfly can only eat milkweed. And so that's why it's important. But another good thing about it is it's a favorite food of almost all pollinators. And there are three main types of milkweed that are native to this area, but all of them are really nice. Okay, next. Okay. Although pollinators aren't looking for food in the wintertime, it's important that we provide winter habitat for them. This means a place for them to hibernate. Many pollinators winter in dead plant material like leaves and mulch and the hollow stems of plants and flowers. So it's important in the fall to leave your cleanup until the spring. Now, this time of year, you might think is a good time to start cleaning up your gardens and getting ready because we're starting to see some of our pollinators. But there's still a lot of pollinators that are hibernating, and they're waiting for it to get warmer. So the rule of thumb is don't clean your gardens until the temperatures get to about 10 degrees Celsius at night, consistently 10 degrees. And that's usually not until about mid or late May. Okay, next. Okay. So what we've learned, pollinators go from flower to flower to collect nectar, their food. And pollen gets on their bodies and then they transfer that to flowers. And this is called pollination. Pollination is needed so flowers can produce fruits and seeds. And this provides us with food and our animal friends with food and also shelter and soil health, okay? Pollinators are a very important part of our ecosystem. We are all a part of a team working together to help create a healthy environment, and together we can be healthy and strong, okay? Thank you. I hope, sorry for all of my problems, but I hope everything was good and you enjoyed this. If you have any questions, we're ready to answer questions. But also, if you think of anything afterwards, you can contact us at Durham Master Gardeners. We have a website. We also are on Facebook and Instagram. So, okay.
Do you guys have any questions? I was going to say, don't be afraid to ask our pros here from Durham Master Gardeners, Holly, Isha, and Corey. They know everything. I see Sedia has her hand up. Do you want to ask a question, sweetie?
Why do bees, when they like when that video came, when you like see the plants from the bees' perspective, why do they always have white on them?
Okay, I can try to answer that for you, Sadia. So what you're asking is why there's white in the picture?
Why there's white in like all of the pictures had like some white on it somehow.
Some white?
Names. So it's different names.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. Did somebody else answer? Because you could be right. I was going to suggest that white usually means that the, you know how color works. We see it because of light. So if the light is different in that area of where the flower is, then maybe that's why you're getting white instead of the bright colors or the other colors.
Okay. Yeah, great question. I think also that you're gonna see bright colors like yellow and white because the flower is trying to get the bee to come to it, so it's gonna have brightness that the bee sees to get that bee to come to the flower.
Thank you.
Very welcome.
The eye of the bee and the butterflies, they also, they're shaped different. And so they'll only take in certain colors like a prism, right? So that's one of the other reasons why it's different.
Hi, Maya, you have a question?
For you on the bag, I see there's these tiny seeds that you can grow like these. So what type of flowers will they grow into?
Christy, can you help with that?
I believe they're just wildflower seeds, sweetie. So if you just sprinkle them, they'll grow some wildflower seeds, which will help pollinate the insects.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? You guys are asking some really great questions. Don't be afraid if you've got any questions.
Are you going to plant those, Zach? Yes, good for you, good for you. Is it Sanan? How do you say your name? Is it Sanan?
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning. It looked like you had your hand up before. Do you have a question for us?
Oh, no.
Okay. It's so good to see all your faces out there. Oh, Caitlin has a question. Go ahead, Caitlin.
How do we get more pollinators in my garden?
Oh, wow. Such a good question. What's in your garden right now? I mean, I know this time of year, probably not very much yet. It's blooming. But what other things have you grown in there?
There are some flowers and trees.
Okay, perfect. So if you looked at the flowers that we had today on our slides with Isha, those are called native plants. And those are plants that have grown in Ontario and in the Pickering area for years and years and years. So basically well over 100 years. So our pollinators are used to those plants. So those are the plants that they'll go looking for. So if you went on your computer and Googled or looked up native plants for Pickering, Ontario, you could come up with places to get the plants and also the names of the plants and pictures. Would that help you?
Yes, that would really help.
Great. And you can also grow vegetables or you can have shrubs, because I don't think you had shrubs in your garden from what you've said. So those all, especially flowering shrubs, the pollinators really like those because there's all those little flowers for them. Thank you for your question. Alexander, is your hand up?
Yes, and also, what do we do if we're already finished the bee home?
You're ahead of the game. We're going to switch over just as soon as we finish the questions to the bee home. Instructors, so you can enjoy your bee home right now. There it is. I don't awesome. Know, maybe the library can help you as part of the presentation or have you as part of the presentation. Other questions? Maybe we should switch over to the library ladies now for crafts.
Is everybody ready to get started on their crafts? First, let's just do a quick stretch up. Just get comfortable, get a little sitting for a while. All right. Now, does everybody have a tin can or a plastic bottle prepared? Perfect. And I see everybody's cut off the tops of their bottles, which is great. If you do not have a bottle that's cut, please ask an adult to do so, just for safety reasons. Don't want anybody getting hurt. I see, yes, Alex has gotten his done, which is amazing. We're just making a little beehive today, just from recyclables around your house. Yep, perfect. Okay, so it's a very simple craft. It just takes a lot of rolling all the little pieces and making sure that they're nice and tight and packed in there for the bees. Okay, so what we're gonna do, let me just switch it over. Everybody has these little pieces of paper. These ones here, you got a pencil? Perfect. What we're gonna do is we're just gonna put the pencil here and we're gonna roll up the papers nice and tight, okay? Very simple. So once you do that, you're gonna roll up the paper really nice and tight. You're gonna get a little piece of tape. You're going to put it there just to keep the papers closed. And from there, slide the pencil up and you have your roll. And what you're going to do is you're just going to add it to whatever can or plastic bottle that you have. You're just going to add it in. All right? And we're going to continue doing that until it's completely full and you have a nice little stacked beehive. Okay? Yeah, I believe I've given everybody quite a bit of paper, but if you ever run out, always feel free to grab some extra scrap paper around your house. It's always good to see what type of resources and materials that you have around your house that you can use for, you know, just to help the environment instead of sending it all to waste. Yeah, Zach, do you have a question? Everything good?
I was going to suggest, Chloe, if they run out of brown paper, if they have any newspaper at home, they can use it.
Oh, yes. Newspaper. Newspaper is a little thinner than regular paper, so it might make it a bit easier to roll it up. And don't worry if the paper is too long. You can always leave it and then just cut it down after to make it smaller and smaller, okay? Anything that I thought was super cool about pollinators? Yep, Maya, see your hand raised?
I never knew bats were pollinators.
Oh. Yeah, you don't typically hear them being pollinators, do you? Especially since they're creatures that are nocturnal, so they're only awake at night.
What do they do to pollinate?
That's a great question.
Okay, your question was, what do the bats do to help pollinate?
Yes.
Okay, so the bats have sort of leathery, sticky wings. So, and they have hair on their faces and on their bodies. So it's just like a lot of the bees. They would fly through, they especially like fruit. So bats and fruit trees often go together. So they would fly through those, all those apple blossoms and cherry blossom, those pretty flowers, and they would have the pollen stick to them just like the other bees. So when they fly through the next flower or the next branch, they spread that pollen just like the bees do to the other blossoms, and that helps us get our fruit.
Right, Sadia, I see you have your hand up as well.
I have a question. Why do bees like to nest in certain things and not in other certain things?
Oh, Isha or Holly, do you want to take that?
Sure. So bees like certain types of nests, like you guys are making right now, because they like tubes, because when they're laying eggs, like a mason bee, what they would do is they would build a little, it's almost like a room for their baby, and they put that pollen cake that I was talking about in, and then they put in a little bit of mud, and then they make another room. So they make a long tube of their eggs so that their babies have all these rooms. So that's what we're making today, is a spot where all the bees can lay their eggs and have their babies. And there are going to be several little spots for their babies with little pollen cakes in them.
Okay, I have one more question.
Sure.
Is there like a bee rescue service that like rescues bees?
That's a really good question. I'm not sure if there's a bee rescue service. Holly, I wish there was a bee one.
I can answer that, Holly.
Oh, okay. Thanks, Corey.
Okay. So especially for honeybees, honeybees and bumblebees are two types of bees that they live in hives and in nests with a large number of other bees. Solitary means by themselves. So solitary bees live alone. They might be a group of them, but they each have their own little home in the soil or the sand or in tubes like you know, where they're laying their eggs, just like you're making today. But bumblebees and honeybees get together in big groups as swarms. And depending on how big the swarm of bees get, the bees may decide that they're going to break off and start their own hive or their own family somewhere else. And sometimes they choose people's houses. So you might have an old tree outside your house, and some summer day you go out and there's hundreds and thousands of bees swarming around that tree. It might look a little scary, but they're just looking for a new home. So if you were to call a beekeeper, someone who looks after bees for honey, they quite often will come and rescue that wild group of bees. And that's what they do. They just gather them all up. They use some smoke because that makes the bees calm. And they gather all those bees up and they take them away to a place that might be better for them to live. So if you did, you know, because most people don't want them, you know, that close to their house or in their walls or in their roof or in the tree right outside the window. So in that way, the beekeeper would be a bee rescue. So that was a perfect question. I don't think I've ever heard that asked before.
Yeah, it's a really good question.
You guys are getting close to finishing up your beehive. It should be getting pretty full. As I mentioned before, you can always get, you can always cut them smaller to make them fit into the tin or the plastic bottle that you have. Just take a piece of string to the side of the tin or the water bottle, and then that will be used to hang it off a branch or a tree, right? And of course, I mean, I got a little creative. I tried to make mine look like a bumblebee. Just to give it some color and decorate it a little bit. I see everybody's doing a great job so far. Yes. My, this will be great job.
And I'm just going to add, if anybody wants to take any pictures of their little pollinator craft that we're doing right now, and you can email it to us at kids@pickeringlibrary.ca. We would love to see them.
Yes. Yes, we will. I think I'm done mine too. Got them all set up and I attached my string to the side too. That way I can hook it up on a branch.
You know what, Chloe, you should put that one out in the reading garden at George Ash, like on a tree or something.
Yes, we do have a reading garden at George Ash. We can put it there.
Yeah, and then it can kind of be our little experiment to see how many bees come.
Yeah. Well, hopefully we'll have some nice, beautiful flowers there too for them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think we're coming to an end here. It looks like everybody has completed their craft. It looks like it was a huge success. So I would like to thank Durham Master Gardeners. I'd like to thank Corey, Holly, and Isha for educating us this morning on all about pollinators. I learned so much, and I can't wait for spring to really arrive so that I can start seeing all the insects flying around and seeing it live in person will be really cool. Look at those crafts. Those look fantastic. And I'd like to thank Chloe and Sedia from the library for helping us with the craft, and Jenna in the background from TRCA to filter through any problems that we have. I think it was a fantastic webinar. I hope you guys enjoyed it as much as I did. And I encourage you to continue on with Earth Month, recycling and reusing and repurposing if we can. And I know the library has some great resources along with the City of Pickering and along with Durham Master Gardeners. We all are doing our part to help the environment. So on behalf of the City of Pickering, Pickering Public Library, TRCA, and Durham Master Gardeners, I'd like to thank you all for coming, and I wish you a great day. Take care, everybody.